100 Carquest Auto Parts stores in the United States and Canada, we'd like to welcome you to the second running of the Carquest Auto Parts 420K. We're glad you're here to join Carquest and our over 25,000 associates for what is sure to be a spectacular event. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the Carquest Auto Parts 420K.
Today, the NASCAR Truck Series will crown a new champion and Big Track Jack Sprague has a firm grip on the title. Ron Hornaday, with a record 17 career wins, wants to add one more. Winston Cup star Bill Elliott will try his luck with a roll of the dice. It is a simply magnificent day with a beautiful backdrop for the final race of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series 1997. We are live at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway, and the Carquest Auto Parts 420K is coming up in just moments. It was here last year that California's Ron Hornaday topped off his 1996 season with a 10th place finish on race day and the series championship. Well, this year won't yield a championship for Hornaday. Instead, it's today's pole sitter, Michigan's Jack Sprague, who must merely start the race to clinch his first NASCAR Touring Series title. Let's go down to pit road. Phil Stevens standing by with Jack Sprague.
Jack Sprague, about to win the championship, has already won the pole. And, Jack, only one thing left on the table. That's the race, and I know you want it.
We want it bad. I tell you, the guys have done a great job on the Sprague Estate Chevrolet. Same truck we raced here last year and won with, and our boss and our buddy Rick's at home watching this thing, and we're going to see if we can win this thing for Quaker State and Hendrick Motorsports, and everybody has worked so hard this year to bring us this championship.
Starting on the outside of row one is Mike Bliss. He had a pretty good qualifying session yesterday, but a lot better than his teammate Bill Elliott, the Winston Cup star. He qualified 19th, but the big story in qualifying may be right here, the number 7 truck of Bodine. Not Jeff Bodine, his 19-year-old son, Barry. And Barry, you're getting the reputation of being the boy wonder.
Yeah, it's having a lot of fun, just getting experience this year, having, you know, a limited schedule. And I like these big tracks. I have a lot of fun at them, run good, been running good all, you know, the few races I've run, so having a lot of fun.
That's the answer. How about the veterans? Glenn Jarrett has a couple of them right now, further back on the grid.
Well, thanks, Bill, you're right. Legendary auto racer A.J. Foyt has a truck in this race. But today, he's the owner. Driving for him, Winston Cup veteran Ken Schrader. Ken, you qualified this thing in 13th. That may not be too unlucky in this field. It's pretty tough out there.
I'll tell you what, we're real happy with the way the truck's running. We'll just have to see. It's a long day. You know, I'm just excited to be driving for AJ. Got driving for Darrell out here last year, so two of my heroes. I'm pumped up.
Well, he is pumped up. He'll be a factor in today's race. He won the Winston West race here last night. He's looking for two in a row here today, Eli.
Glenn, thank you, and welcome again, everyone, to the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. And Buddy Baker, you know, we've talked about the championship. Certainly, Sprague wraps it up just by starting, but a lot of other positions still up for grabs today.
Eli, there's room for a lot of changing from second to tenth. I mean, it's very close right now. A lot of people are going to move up, a lot back.
And whatever you like in NASCAR racing, whether it's the high speeds, the drafting, the aggressive racing, the Craftsman Truck Series has all of that and then some.
Well, it reminds me of the days when I first started racing. These guys that go out there, that was when sheet metal was cheap, and these guys really went at it. And these guys race every lap, and nobody settles for second.
Now some other names to talk about. The best qualifying Dodge for the day, Bob Keselowski.
Well, Bob Keselowski has already won in Richmond. I think he'll be a player today.
How about Mike Bliss?
Mike Bliss with Barry Dodson in the pits there. he stands a good chance to run very well on major speedways.
And the series' top rookie is Kenny Irwin Jr.
Kenny Irwin Jr., bravery, bravery, bravery. Moving on from this series, going to Robert Yates next year. He will be a player today. He'd love to win.
So you get the idea. A lot of storylines here today, but we're set to go racing. Let's go trackside for the command we've all been waiting for.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
Of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series is sponsored by the 3,400 Carquest Auto Parts stores across North America. You'll find it at...
Welcome back, everybody, to the Las Vegas Motor Speedway, where it is as wonderful a day as you can hope for. Probably wasted those two numbers on the humidity, buddy. That's really nothing at 29%. A beautiful day to go racing the season finale for the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. Here's the starting grid. Jack Sprague is fifth pole of the year. Mike Bliss is 10th front row start. You've heard from Barry Bodine, and we talked about Bob Keselowski, the winner at Richmond. Last year's rookie is Brian Reffner. Chuck Bowen was second at Phoenix a weekend ago. Butch Miller and Joe Ruttman in row number 4. Lonnie Rush and Jay Sauter in row 5. Kenny Irwin, who moves to NASCAR Winston Cup. He'll start along with Rick Corelli, who celebrates a birthday today in row 6. Kenny Schrader, who won here last night, and Ron Hornaday. Kevin Harvick and Mike Skinner, the 95 Series champion. Rick Crawford of Mobile, he's second in the Rookie of the Year battle. And Brendan Gaughan, he's the local favorite. Bill Elliott and Idaho's Randy Tolsma, their 19th and 20th. Rich Bickle and Doug George, he and his wife are expecting a baby any moment now. Stacy Compton and Troy Beebe in row 12. Wayne Anderson and Boris Sedd in the 13th row. Lance Norrick and Curtis Markham in row 14. Brian Cunningham and Mike Wallace, who has three straight top 10 finishes. He'll go 30th. Jimmy Hensley, Tony Raines, they're in on provisionals, and so are Ron Barfield and Tony Roper. Then by virtue of last night's qualifying race, Kenny Bouchard, Rick Johnson, Dave Resendiz, West Coast regular Ron Esau, the Winston West Series champ crowned last night, Butch Gilliland, and from the ARCA Tour, Frank Kimmel, a 40-truck starting field here this afternoon. Now, 62 trucks are on hand, buddy. Some pretty good names didn't make it.
Yeah, we were very surprised that Brett Bodine didn't make it. Toby Butler, T.J. Clark, Terry Cook, Tammy Joe Kirk. Those are names we thought would be in the show today.
Again, a grand total of 62 teams were on hand. Let's take a look at those who'll be carrying cameras around the speedway for us. The Econolodge in-truck camera will be aboard Jack Sprague's machine. Mike Bliss and the team ASE Ford will be giving us a ride around the mile-and-a-half Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Bob Keselowski, we talked about the Mopar Performance Dodge, best qualifying Dodge Ram. Ron Hornaday, the Napa Brakes Chevrolet truck. Rich Bickle, the Sears diehard Chevy, he is second in points. And Jimmy Hensley driving for the King, Richard Petty. That's the Cummins engine Dodge. And those fellows will be providing us the rides around the speedway. Let's take a look at some of the numbers. And again, if you're not familiar with the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, buddy, two segments to the race.
Yeah, you can see the segments there, 88 laps and then 87 laps on the second segment. You know one thing about it, if you're a little bit off, you get to work on the truck at halfway and really get it dialed in. So you're not out of the race if you don't get laps.
Qualifying record today, Jack Sprague at 161.310 miles an hour. And remember, as soon as Sprague on the pole comes to the line, he'll win the championship. And that's the racetrack they'll be battling. High speeds, if you like it, you come to the right spot. The pace truck now gets set to pull away. The green flag will fly. The championship will belong to Jack Sprague. And now he's won the war. Let's start today's battle. They work off turn number 2. Again, the banking comes into play some. Just 12 degrees as they head towards you in turn 3.
Eli wide. We're talking about three and four wide. You can see from that shot, they were going down the back straightaway, four wide there. You can see Hornaday already moving up into contention.
He's got Sauter and the three truck to his inside. Joe Ruttman just ahead. One lap in the books. Problems there as Cunningham's truck will slide off the banking and caution in turn number four on lap number two. Doesn't take long, Brian Cunningham, as he went through the corner. You recognize possibly the paint scheme. Remember the great name Briggs Cunningham, buddy, and that's the same paint scheme that his granddad used to run in his heyday.
Yeah, his granddad was quite a road racer, and that was his colors and the stripes there. Brings back a lot of the history of the sport.
Now watch the left side of your screen, and we'll take a look again and see if we can pick up what happened to Cunningham. Watch the left of your screen, that white truck.
Oh, Cunningham got down below the yellow line there on the bottom, made contact with the 19 truck there. That's Tony Raines. You can see both of them in big trouble there. Cunningham getting into the outside. Look at everybody else trying to get by there without making contact.
This is the first time for Raines here at this racetrack. And there you see Cunningham, the aftermath. And caution is on the speedway. So Jack Sprague is the race leader. And he has won the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series Championship for 1997. We'll be right back. We are back with you at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway, working the first caution flag of the afternoon as Brian Cunningham and Tony Raines spun their trucks in turn four. There you see the Cunningham machine and the speedy drive being applied. A lot of oil on the racetrack. They are going to give the field the one to go signal, hoping that they'll be able to get back to racing in just another lap around the mile and a half here in Las Vegas. Us now on the phone line is a gentleman who you well know the storyline, Rick Hendrick, who is one of motorsports most well-known team owners, battling leukemia at home in North Carolina. But Rick, the Eli Gold here, and this is going to be the very best medicine for you. Congratulations.
Thank you, Eli. It's really, really special. Jack and Dennis and all the guys have done a super job this year, and just really proud of them. And just thank all the fans for their support, and just trying to do what the doctor says and hopefully get back there to see y'all soon.
Well, we want you back, Rick. It's Buddy Baker talking now, and man, what a year. I mean, you, Jeff Gordon in your Winston Cup effort right now, leading going into the final race in Atlanta, and your championship here. You have to just be thrilled with everything, and it's nice to hear that you're doing better.
Well, you know, we got some great guys, and they work awful hard, and I guess this means they don't need me, buddy.
Oh, no, that's not it.
I don't know about that at all. Listen, Rick, cinch up the seatbelts on your recliner. We're going back green, but it's great to have you on the telecast with us today.
Thank you, Lava.
Rick Hendrick joining us live from his home in North Carolina. Great to have him with us, and certainly the championship that Jack Sprague has won today is, as they say, the very best medicine that a man can have. Green is in the air on the restart lap number six here in Las Vegas. Jack Sprague, this has gotten gone in a hurry, buddy.
Eli, you can see just behind him, Mike Bliss there going down the back straightaway. Does not close in at all. That Hendrick's power is going down the straightaway.
Bliss is second. The white truck, that's Barry Bodine running in third. Brian Reffner is that fourth truck in line. Last year's Cintas Rookie of the Year. He's had an up and down season. There's a good stand up into the field. He's Keselowski. Butch Miller is in the 21.
Chuck Bowden in the 99. They were running three wide coming off the corner just a second ago. That's Hornaday in the 16 truck. The blue one there, he's moving right up through the field.
As you can see, single file, the three truck further back in 11th spot, that's Jay Sauter. Back up front again. Bliss and Sprague battling for the lead. Bill Elliott, if you're curious, is back in 20th, Glenn.
Yeah, he is, Eli, although he started back in the field. I don't expect him to stay there very long today. The crew changed the engines this morning. They had a leak, an oil leak in the engine. They put a brand new Robert Yates engine in. They feel like it's got about 50 horsepower more than the engine they took out, which should be worth about a half a second a lap on the racetrack. I don't expect Bill to stay back there for very long.
Bill Elliott ran this race a year ago, if you were with us, and he finished second that day, trailing only the race leader at the line. And Tim Brewer calling the shots on his truck a year ago.
Eli, you see him going down into turn one. This is looking back at the front straightaway. You can see the silver truck there, Bliss, moves in a little bit in the corner. He gets right up on the tailgate as they start down towards the back straightaway. Watch this 24 truck about halfway down the straightaway. Put some distance between them.
Looking back, you see three wide battling all the way back there around fifth position. But we'll ride right here as Bliss waits, and there you see the battle we were talking about, the 99 bound, the 29, that, oh, and right off the wall. Nice save right there coming through the main straightaway for Irwin.
That was the 93 truck, Skinner that got into the wall there, and he was very, very lucky to catch it back with radial tires. When you get that crossed up, hey, that was great driving.
There's Mike Skinner. If you weren't with us earlier, we'll refresh your memory as Tony Roper makes an unscheduled stop on the Bob Brevac-owned truck. Skinner right there in the 93, that was the truck that was on display at the big automotive show here in Las Vegas this week. And after wrecking the primary truck here on Friday, they went to the Las Vegas Convention Center, got the truck, and got him back to work. As we have problems in turn number one, just behind the leaders, it is Brian Reffner, of whom we were bragging moments ago. He had a lot of oil that we could clearly see coming from behind that truck as he went off into the corner.
Eli, you can see the smoke there, but going into turn one, the motor let go, and you could just see a lot of debris come out from under the truck, and oil was going everywhere. So this will take a little bit to clean up because it does have a wide oil patch going into turn one.
So caution is on the speedway at lap number 10. Second time today that caution has come out. Ryan Reffner had a series of DNFs, did not finish races earlier this year. And now watch the upper right of your screen on this replay and you'll see what we saw.
Well, you can see right there, it's turned loose and he started down into one. Now you can see the parts actually flying out from under that truck as he goes in the corner, gets sideways. Lucky catch there because there's a lot of oil going on the right rear tire. What a great drive he just put on too.
And there is Brian Reffner heading back to the pits. CBS Sports coverage of the Carquest Auto Parts 420K will continue after this message and a word from your local station. Back with you here at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. And unfortunately for Brian Reffner, there is a familiar sight. The 13th time this year that he'll end a race behind the wall. That is the most DNFs did not finish of any team on the series this year. And he's put down all sorts of debris on the racetrack. While we've got a chance, remember next weekend, Saturday, Eastern time. If you're just joining us, Barry Bodine, a big-time story here this weekend. He's running in fourth right now, Bill Stevens. What's the update?
Well, his crew chief is Steve May. Your boy's got a whole bunch of guys munching on his tailgate. What's he telling you about the race so far?
Well, right now, he's telling us he's real comfortable. We've done some long runs here since we've got here, and we're pretty quick off the truck on this Rhino Lining Ford. He's happy, and we're just going to sit back and through the first half, drive a safe race. The reason we're here is to get some laps under Barry's belt. 19 years old. And he ceases to amaze us.
And his dad, Jeff, is up in the grandstand. He's spotting today.
There you see Barry Bodine. Good run for him. Jeff Bodine, we happened to chat with him a short while ago, buddy. He came by and visited with us up here in the booth, and he's a very proud papa.
Exactly. He is a very proud papa. And I tell you what, Hornaday's moved all the way up to fifth. We have a problem here with Boris Said. They have the hood up on his truck. they're working on it there. That's not a good sign this early in the race.
Second or third time he's been in, Glenn.
Yeah, it is, Eli. He's got a miss. It's a high-speed miss. They've got the engine running right now. The crew just changed the distributor cap and all the plug wires. They thought that might solve the problem. It did not, so Boris had to come back in. The only good side to it is that at least this problem occurred under a caution. They're not losing near as many laps as if this had happened under green, but they're scratching their heads down here right now. Don't know what's wrong.
Noted road racer, Boris said, but of all the fellas on the circuit, buddy, he may be the one who has made the most progress in acclimating himself to these ovals, be it the big tracks or the short tracks.
Well, he's got an ace in the hole. He's got Ernie Irvin helping him set this truck up. He's actually out here with him this weekend and assisting him on setting the truck up. And Boris is a very good driver, and all he needs is the knowledge of how to set it up for an oval. So he looks for him to be a big player next year. He's got a year under his belt now.
Folks, after the race, you can jump on to the CarQuest 420K website. We'll have a complete wrap-up of all that goes on here, all the stats, the standings. We'll have in-depth looks at all the NASCAR news from here in Las Vegas by our team of motorsports journalists. You can go inside a successful pit stop. There'll be a fully animated coach's edge. You can get it all at the computer address, cbs.sportsline.com. Eli Gold with Buddy Baker. Bill Stevens, Glenn Jarrett, Field getting the one-to-go signal, as you saw and ride with the Quaker State Chevy truck, the series champion for 1997, Jack Sprague. He has had a very consistent year. Not the winningest driver on the circuit. Hornaday's got seven wins, but consistency, buddy. This guy, if he doesn't finish first, he finishes second. If it's not second, he'll finish third. He doesn't have those 35th and 40th place finishes.
Well, that's the important part when you're running for the championship. And I talked to Mike Bliss earlier in the week, and he said next year, only trucks. He's not going to go back and forth to other division. He wants to be up front. He wants to win the championship. He said he's going to go 100% for the truck championship next year. You can see his office there. That's what it looks like inside the truck. See him going back and forth with the steering wheel. He's getting all the debris off the tires and getting ready for the green flag.
And since he won at the California Speedway in Fontana earlier this year, you know he likes the high-speed tracks. And folks, if you're new to the series, let's mention again that the aerodynamics on the trucks a little bit different than you might have in a NASCAR Winston Cup or a Busch Series car. A little more lift, isn't there?
Well, there's a little more lift on the front, but this is going to be a beautiful start here. We're riding with the leader as he comes for the green flag.
Green flag is in the air. And to the stripe. Bliss shows the way, lap number 17. Switches there on the dashboard, buddy. What was he doing?
You can do that sometimes. That might be a reset for his tachometer. He might have over-revved it a little bit there and said, I'm getting rid of this evidence early.
That's all the speedy drive that they put down after the Brian Reffner problem. That's what that dust is that you're seeing.
You can see Bliss right now really got a good run. But Hornaday, look at him go. He is moving up through the pack here. He's in the 16 truck going down into the corner there. You can see this truck is really handling well. You see him moving around just behind him, a pack of trucks coming in there. Chuck Bound, he's putting him down going into turn one as they head for the back straightaway.
And Chuck can't get back in line, Glenn.
Well, you know the way he got up there, Eli, on that restart, a lot of guys jammed up. They thought the leader was going to take off, but he didn't. And Chuck timed it just right. He went all the way from eighth to third. But you can see right now he's not able to stay up there. He's dropping some of those positions that he gained on the restart. But terrific restart for Chuck Bound.
He'll get in line in fifth ahead of that white truck number seven of Barry Bodine. Watch Joe Ruttman in the 80. That's that yellow fronted truck you see.
I'm going to watch Kenny Trader in that red truck there. He was three wide up there where all that oil dry was. He was lucky to get back and make it double wide going down into one there, because that's still slick on the high side of the racetrack. Nobody wants to be up there going into turn one.
Of course, the option was mess up and feel the wrath of A.J. Foyt. I mean, you're going to stay right in there, Schrader will in that 50.
You see Kenny Irwin there in the 98, and just on the outside there, that's Kenny Schrader we were just talking about.
There you see the truck that normally is driven by Butch Miller. Brendan Gaughan is the local Las Vegas favorite. His dad is a hotel magnate here in the area, and he's making an unscheduled stop. Good scramble now between ninth and eighth place. 98 truck, that's Irwin. He'll lose the spot to Schrader in the 50. Mike Wallace also, that white truck, number 52.
That's Randy Tulsa in the 61 there, going down on the high side of the racetrack. I tell you what, right now, Jay Sauter in the 3 there, these guys are flying around this racetrack, and you can see 3 wide don't mean a thing to these guys. They'll try it most anywhere.
Racetrack that was not built for 200 miles an hour, buddy, and that might be a factor here. They said, we don't want 200 miles an hour. Give us 170, 175, and make it a racy facility, and they've hit on it here in Las Vegas.
Well, the fans want to come out and see trucks and race cars go at it, and they don't want to see them follow each other around the racetrack. They want them to do what they're doing now. Race hard, side by side. You never know who's going to come out of the corner in the lead.
That yellow truck on the inside, Randy Tolsma, he's running 11. He was the winner earlier this year in Bakersfield, California. Longtime USAC midget star. Tried to qualify for the Indianapolis 500 a couple of years ago. But he has really come on the scene here in the second half of the season and become a major force. There's old Bill Elliott right there, the 94 on the move.
Blue and white truck there, just behind the 3 truck of Jay Sauter. You can see he's moving up also. And here comes Bob Keselowski, making it 3, trying to make it 3, going down into turn 1.
And that light blue truck, number 14, that's Rick Crawford from Mobile, Alabama. Second in the Cintas Rookie of the Year standings this year. Second only to Kenny Irwin Jr., who will likely wrap up that championship here this afternoon. But nevertheless, Crawford, a longtime short track ace through Alabama, Tennessee, Georgia, Mississippi, he too has really established himself as a serious threat for future races here. We mentioned Brendan Gaughan with an unscheduled stop on pit road. Glenn, what were they finding there?
Well, Eli, the main reason he came in that time was he got into the wall on that restart, and he was afraid he might have messed up the right side tires or maybe even bent the rear end housing. So he came in, had the crew check it over. That was okay. He also, early when they just started the engines up, I saw a lot of smoke come out. He now has a miss. Now let's go to Bill Stevens.
I'm with Todd Berry, the crew chief for Jay Sauter. Jay's having a good run, and you're telling me he's still learning the line.
Yeah, he ain't got a lot of speedway experience, but he's just trying to figure out the best groove. He's kind of a little loose off the corner now, trying to run a higher line.
Not bad on-the-job training, guys.
That's right. Jay Sauter ran here a year ago, but he spun out early. But he had a good test here late last month. There is Jay running in the top 10 right now, behind Kenny Schrader and ahead of Bill Elliott. Up front, no change. There's the spread. Mike Bliss, left of your screen, the leader. Second place is Jack Sprague. Just joining us, we've had a couple of cautions. One on lap 2 when Brian Cunningham spun with Tony Raines. One on lap number 10 when Brian Reffner lost an engine and went to the garage. So Reffner is out, as is Troy Beebe, who parked his truck very early.
You know, as we watch the leaders there, we heard a very interesting story last night when they were qualifying. And the reason they said that he didn't win was somebody lost a screwdriver on a truck that qualified just before. And as he went down in the corner, he realized that he couldn't go regular line, and he had been running fast, so he had to vary his line and go higher, and actually cost him the pole.
The pole was 161.310 miles an hour, and Bliss was 161.204. Now, there is Bliss in the team ASE entry. Behind him, running 6/10 of a second back, there's the point leader and the champion from this year, Jack Sprague. Then you see a goodly margin that they have built up now. 4 seconds, we wait for the High Plains Drifter to come into view. That is Rick Corelli from Denver, Colorado, celebrating a birthday here today. Then you've got Ron Hornaday and Ruttman in a pretty good scramble for 4th and 5th.
Well, you can see Ruttman drafting right there on Hornaday, trying to stay in the draft. Joe Ruttman has a lot of super speedway. You can see coming off the corner here, less than a truck length as they head down the back straightaway. Joe Ruttman will be a player before today's over.
Ruttman in the 80. He's already won on the mile at Walt Disney World back in January. He won last week on the mile in Phoenix, and there he makes the move for 4th.
Well, you were talking about downforce on the front of these trucks, and what happened to Hornaday just then is he went in the corner, the front of the truck tried to go up towards the wall there. He had to back down the throttle. Joe Ruttman able to turn under and make the pass.
Jack Roush power.
Now
he trips up right back and says, help yourself.
That's what it feels like when the air really changes as a truck gets behind another one. It changes the airflow over the front truck. So when you can see Ruttman took off pushing there. Now he's going back by again. These guys are going at it.
This is fourth and fifth on your screen. 29 laps into the 175 here this afternoon. Scramble now, Keselowski and Sauter, the 29 and the 3 trucks respectively. They're 11th and 12th. Everybody working their way around the slower machine, so no chance to make an inside move. They went by Rick Crawford there, who had to whoa it down just a bit as he got a bit sideways off the corner.
Rich Bickle in the 17 truck seems to be running very well right now. That's the one you can't miss out there. We're riding with him. As a matter of fact, down the front straightaway, you can see the truck very good getting in the corner. You'll notice he closes right up on him. In the center part of the corner, he's able to stay a little bit lower. He ought to get a good run up out of turn two. This will give you a good idea what this racetrack looks like to the drivers. This is a perfect angle for you to get a feeling of how these trucks run around this racetrack.
That's a 1,572-foot back straightaway. Turns 3 and 4, bank 12 degrees. Then this front stretch with a dog leg, 2,275 feet long, and it's banked 9 degrees. Mike Bliss still the leader as we watch this battle midway. There's Boris Shedd. He's had a myriad of problems. He's already 15 laps down in 37th spot. Mike Bliss still the race leader by a second on Jack Sprague now. Glenny's starting to pull away a little bit.
Well, he is in a very, very Dodson. You got two fast trucks out there right now. What's Mike saying about his truck? And man, I see Bill Elliott on the move.
Bill is on the move. He's a running mate. As the fuel load goes off, getting around pretty big springs here, it's going to get a little bit tighter. But when we put fuel in with old tires, it should come back to neutral. Right now, it's pretty good.
Mike reports it's just a little tight in the middle. Bill Elliott has moved from 19th tonight. Here is Bill.
I'm with Ron Keselowski. He's the crew chief for his brother, Bob. You guys have moved back since the green flag. Everything all right?
We started with a real low air pressure, and it's going to take a while to get it filled up. We're going back, and now we're coming back forward again. So we're doing okay.
No major problems. You're just kind of playing your time before halftime.
Yeah, no major problems. Just the trial. Maybe for the second half, we won't go that long.
Oh, we'll wait and see.
Veteran racer right there, Ron Keselowski. He and his brother Bob, longtime ARCA campaigners. There's the race leader now by 1 1/3. 1 1/3 seconds. There's Ruttman and Hornaday. They've not stopped battling at all.
And just behind them there in the 7 truck, that's the Bodine kid. And I tell you what, he's doing a great job. There's not a school, not anything you could ever put a kid through to teach him what he's learning right now, race conditions.
Got to get out there, get that seat time.
Are a great idea, but let me tell you, when you get out there and go at it, that's a college there.
We are working lap number 35 of 175. Mike Bliss is the leader here in Las Vegas. In Las Vegas, no change among the top three. The only difference being is that what had been 1 3/10 of a second lead for Bliss, now nearly 2 seconds of an advantage. Sprague is second, Corelli third, Joe Ruttman is fourth, and here we ride with Bliss as he begins to put some trucks a lap down. He goes past the West Coast veteran Ron Esau, putting him one lap in arrears. Let's go to Glenn Jarrett. And Glenn, Joe Ruttman, doing well, and Chuck Bound, conversely, all of a sudden going backwards. What's
the deal? You're right, Eli. Didn't mean to step on you there, but Chuck Bound is just about to go a lap down. Remember that great restart he had? He's reporting his truck very, very loose in the middle right now. He can't drive it. It's just not doing what he wants it to do. Meanwhile, his teammate, Joe Ruttman, running in fourth, says his truck is a little tight when he's by himself, but when Hornaday moves up right on his rear deck, it really loosens it up, helps him get through the corners, helps the truck turn better. So he likes that pressure on the rear bumper right now.
Well, let me address that for the first-time viewers here. When they're talking about a truck being loose, that means the back end of the truck is not getting the grip it needs to. It's actually trying to slide into the corner, and that's the loose condition. Of course, push is when you turn the steering wheel left and nothing happens. The truck wants to go straight. That's what push is.
Meanwhile, Ron Hornaday, he's running in fifth right now, but he has gone six races without a top five finish. Is Fred Graves a little more encouraged here today, Bill?
Eli, he is loving what he's seeing. That truck is in fifth place after qualifying 14th. But Fred, you say you'd like a caution to get some gas in the truck.
Well, I think everybody right now is hoping for a caution so they get enough gas in to make it to a halfway break. If not, there's going to be a flurry of green flag stops here in a little while, and hopefully we don't go down a lap when we do it.
Let's go to Glenn Jarrett.
Guys, I've moved down into Bill Elliott's pitch, and as we've been monitoring, he is one of the fastest trucks on the racetrack. I've got his crew chief, Mike Bean, here, and Mike, that's a rocket ship you guys got out there.
Yeah, I tell you, we change engines, you know, and it's really, trucks working real well, you know. We just need to get the halfway mark here, get caught up, and see what happens, you know. Jimmy and Barry, they really gave us a good truck, so we'll see what happens.
Okay, best of luck. We'll keep an eye on Bill. Eli, he is on the move.
He is. He just gets by Hornaday there for fifth. Buddy Baker with the NASCAR Winston Cup teams running here early next season. Can Bill and Mike Beam, his crew chief from whom we just heard there, can they get enough notes out of today's event to try and help them with a car here next year?
Eli, not only today, he ran last night also in an event out here. Mike Beam was here, and he now has three races out here already. Ran in the truck last year. They're doing, look at this racing going right here. This is what I like, guys. When they start running three wide, two wide through the corner, you can see they're giving a little nerf in there, letting him know, hey, I won't buy.
Now everybody trying to get by. Norick is there trying to stay from going a lap down. The number two is Mike Bliss. He is the race leader, and he is just marching through the field. Norick is in 25th position, that number 90 truck there, who drifts high. And you can see right there vividly the handling difference. Bliss glued to the inside of the track. Everybody else, or most everybody else, going way wide. A big difference here today in the haves and the have-nots.
Bill Elliott told me this racetrack is so similar to Michigan as far as the way you drive it. You know, he won a many a race there.
Yeah.
And what he said, you go down in the corner and you don't get completely out of the throttle as you start down in the corner. Look at this great race. Bodine here, Hornaday, side by side going in the corner.
And again, that's Barry Bodine, not Jeff. Jeff is here watching. Uncle Brett is in town, but that's Barry Bodine who's qualified.
Oh, don't come over.
Bodine is in seventh. He wants sixth.
Well, he's going to grab it. Wow, look at him go through the center part of the corner. You can see him just moving right away from Hornaday. That's a heads-up pass there by Bodine.
They went by the 63 of Rick Johnson. You just saw that red and white truck being bypassed.
You can see Hornaday's truck there in the center part of the corner going right out of the groove and right up towards the outside of the racetrack, and Bodine able to stay right on the bottom. That's the difference in the two.
We're at lap 47 of 175, as you see with the full scoring rundown in the upper left-hand corner of your screen.
Here comes Bob Keselowski in the 29, moving by Hornaday. Right now, Hornaday's truck will not turn in the center part of the corner, making it very difficult for him.
Maybe the most popular win of the year among the other competitors was Keselowski's win in Richmond, Virginia. You're not going to find a nicer guy, a harder working guy. It's a family operation, basically, and so many drivers said if he couldn't win, it was great to see Keselowski finally win.
Even Jimmy Spencer went over and provided a little bit of help as far as what the radial tire is doing, and actually everybody there was pulling for him. It was a great win, and let me tell you, he can drive. He is not just a short track driver. He can run major speedway as well.
the higher side of the banking. Hornaday tries to hold off the challenge. He'll hang on to seventh for the moment as Mike Bliss continues to lead. Jack Sprague, Rick Corelli, Ruttman, and Elliott, your top five. Complete here at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway through the first 51 laps. There you see the numbers with an average speed that has dropped because of two caution flags, one for Brian Cunningham, one for Brian Reffner. Those who are already in the garage area, there you see. So the attrition rate somewhat high here in the early going. Eli Gold, Buddy Baker, Bill Stevens, Glenn Jarrett, and Mike Bliss by two full seconds, that number two Team ASE truck. On the pit lane, pit stops beginning now, Kevin Harvick. First one in, the Spears Manufacturing entry takes fuel. Again, no tire changes in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series unless you've got a total flat. Otherwise, you can't change a tire. If you do, it's a five-lap penalty.
That was a long pit stop for fuel. Those cans are supposed to dump in less than 7 seconds, and that took about 14 seconds for that last can. I would say something's wrong with the fuel system where it wouldn't dump into the fuel cell quick enough.
First pit stop coming here at lap number 54, the first of the scheduled stops. Bill Stevens, what are they saying within the next handful of laps for most everybody?
Well, Eli, it's very interesting. A little cat and mouse game going on down here with some of the teams. Nobody wants to be the first to come in for fuel. They want to wait and see what some of the lead trucks do before they come in here. If you were down at the casinos, you might say that they weren't going to show their hold card right away.
Let's not talk about casinos. Trust me when I tell you they're not keeping the lights burning out here from all the winners. I can attest to that. You saw pit stops while Bill was chatting. We had Mike Wallace who came in. Kenny Irwin Jr. came in. We're riding with Bob Keselowski now in seventh.
You could see Bob Keselowski there. The one thing that we have an advantage for with the TV camera on top of this truck, we can make that thing clean the windscreen so you can see what's going on. Three wide down the back straightaway there. You can see Keselowski in the 29 there, kind of backing out of it. Then I think I'll wait till he does. Now he starts to move to the inside. What I was saying, though, the windshield probably looked like that windscreen that they cleaned just a second ago.
You saw the 9. That's Ron Esau again, former Rookie of the Year in NASCAR Winston West, the number 9 truck, former Southwest Tour Series champion from back in the 80s. He was going yet another lap down during that three-wide exchange. Pit stops continuing for some. As you watch Keselowski, now back to the race leader, Mike Bliss.
And the trailer's down on pit road. It won't be very long because most of these trucks are pretty much the same as far as. Looks like Dave Resende may be out. That's Dave Resende's in the 35 there. Looks like he might be. Pardon me, that is not.
Ron Barfield.
That is Barfield.
That is the former Resende's ride. And is he out of gas, Glenn?
Yeah, that's what we're hearing, Eli. Right now, the truck's out of gas. He tried to stretch it a little too far. Ooh, big trouble in Ken Schrader's pit as they're putting fuel in the number 50 power team truck. They've got fuel all over the pit road, spilled everywhere. So the pit window is now. We should see the Schrader down and away now. He stalls it. We should see the leader coming in within the next 2 to 3 laps.
So a lengthier stop with some problems there for Kenny Schrader. You saw Ron Barfield's truck slow on the track. Rich Bickle getting that fill of fuel. And he's back on the speedway, currently second in points. All of these stops under green, lap 58. Race leader Mike Bliss took over in lap number 17. There he is. Jack Sprague led from the beginning, our pole sitter, and Bliss is coming in. So the race leader will give up his 2.5-second lead on Jack Sprague. He goes around Barfield. You saw that truck that was limping around towards the pit lane. And now Barry Dodson and the crew will wait to service the Team ASE truck. Glenn Jarrett's down there.
And guys, they're going to try to stretch this a little bit. The other teams will be going with a can and a half of fuel. They're going to try to make it on only one can to the halfway point. He's down in weight. Wow, that was quick. That should gain us some track time.
Eli, you could tell there wasn't any problem with their fuel system. That took about 5.5 seconds to dump that can of fuel.
Other pit stops now. Oh, we may not. We're going to have a caution for Barfield right there. He stops near the entrance to pit road, and this is going to jumble things just a bit because a number of the teams have stopped. A number of them haven't, and caution being displayed for the third time. It will come out at lap 61 as Ron Barfield apparently runs out of fuel, as we heard the report from the pit lane, and could go no further. That's one thing about a racetrack very much like Pocono and others where the banking is not particularly steep. You can't really coast all the way around.
You can see his pit crews could run all the way down in the corner to get him out of the harm's way there, and they're pushing him in.
Meanwhile, Barry Bodine has been on the pit lane for service. There is the number 7 truck, Bill.
Well, his crew chief, Steve May, just told me that Barry went right by their pit area, but it was by design. What happened, Steve?
Hang on one second.
I can tell you basically what happened. The yellow flag came out. Barry didn't want to come in and stop. He would have been penalized the lap. He shot right back out again. Steve, is everything under control now?
Yeah, we're under control. We were going to come in to fuel up, and just as we came down pit road, the caution came out, so we told him to keep going. A few people did get down lap. It looks right now like we're on the lead lap, so we're holding on.
He's just a kid, but he kept his cool, guys.
He did, and he really wouldn't have been penalized a lap in the true sense of being given a penalty, but he would have been penalized in actuality because he would have been caught on the pit lane during that caution period.
Look at Jack Sprague. He's just riding along there, very comfortable. You can see just beside his helmet up there, that's up. Oh, he didn't want somebody that close to him. We don't have stoplights on this, so that's to let a guy know that you're not happy with him.
CBS Sports coverage of the Carquest Auto Parts 420K will continue after this message and a word from your local station.
Sparky. Oh, come on, Jenny. It's not that bad.
And that was the AT&T Anytime Anywhere offer. Get local airtime as low as 7 cents a minute in Chicago and in AT&T cities coast to coast. Plus, you get features like paging, voicemail, caller ID, even email.
It's a cat joke. Okay, listen, you guys. These two cats...
Call anytime in AT&T cities across the country at your local Chicago rate.
I'm always on this thing. I gotta talk to real people sometimes. I'm sorry, that's not what I meant. It's a human thing, you know?
Call now and your next call could be just 7 cents a minute with AT&T Digital PCS.
You can't be so sensitive.
Tragedy brings couples closer together. Next, Gail King.
Welcome back, everyone, as pit stops continue under caution for those who had not pitted just before the yellow came out. And it's going to be Jack Sprague who continues as the race leader now. Bliss had the lead, then he made his pit stop. Jack Sprague, who led early, has reassumed the top spot. And this is a very interesting situation, buddy, as often happens. We even saw it happen with the NASCAR Winston Cup teams a couple of weeks ago. When the caution flies in the middle of a sequence of green flag stops, some guys benefit and some really don't.
Well, some benefit if they don't go a lap down, but those that go a lap down, of course, you can see right now, some people are not real happy. But,
that's Walter Wallace on the left of the screen. They call him WW, one of the NASCAR officials. Barry Dodson is on the right of the screen. He is Mike Bliss's crew chief, and they are discussing the placement of everybody on the racetrack. Now, Bliss pitted at lap 60. The caution flew on 61. And at this very moment, everybody is reconfirming, even NASCAR, going over their scoring tapes to make sure that everybody is in the correct position. Because this is one instance where the scoring really can kind of get crossed up just a tad. So NASCAR is going to double check themselves before we restart.
Eli, before we saw Barry Dodson down there discussing this with NASCAR, I was talking about the guys that didn't get a lap down. They benefit because they're ahead of everybody that stopped. But let me tell you, a lot of people got caught a lap down on that stop.
Don't forget, we'll update all that's taking place and all that's gone on this weekend as you jump on to our CarQuest 420K website. A complete wrap-up when this one is done. All sorts of in-depth news from the team of motorsports journalists. CBS.Sportsline.com is the computer address for you for all your latest NASCAR racing news. Glenn, what are you hearing? I know you've been kind of eavesdropping down there with Barry Dobson in the bunch.
Yeah, Eli, and I just finished. He was telling me what he's in big discussion right now with NASCAR, and what he's saying is his driver, Mike Bliss, pitted under the green. So when the trucks that waited and had and got to pit under caution, they were held at the end of pit road till the guys that were still on the racetrack that had already pitted, they were held at the end of pit road, those guys pitting under caution, until the full field went by. Jack Sprague was one of those trucks that pitted under caution, but somehow he is up toward the middle part of the pack. So that's what he's arguing about, that Sprague passed trucks on the access road. Let's go to Bill.
In all the confusion of that pit stop, you might have missed that Rich Bickle in the 17 truck came in twice. The second time, not only for more fuel, but also to take a little rubber out of the suspension. And, Buddy, maybe you can explain what that is.
Okay, what that is, it's an insert that goes into the coil spring on the right front or right rear or left rear. And when you pull it out, it makes the spring softer. So what they're doing is actually adjusting the chassis by taking that out. And they have a wire in there where they can jerk it out, and it does not take much time. And it's a real easy way to soften one corner or the other.
Kind of looks like a hockey puck or a half of a hockey puck if they put in a half of a spring rubber with a little handle attached on it.
You would say that. You've done hockey a bunch. But, yeah, it looks kind of like that, but it fits on the spring itself.
Let's go down to pit road.
Well, guys, let's update that again. As we were just finished explaining what was going on, NASCAR must have listened to Barry Dodson because they held Sprague and let several trucks go by. Are you satisfied?
Yeah, they do a good job of listening. What happens if you pit under green, you know, you blend in where you can. If you pit under caution, you're held at the end of pit road. You're offered to go back on the racetrack in the way you left pit road after everybody else has come by. So I think that group of trucks will move back and get behind the 90 if everything's done correctly. They do a good job upstairs.
And this man right here does a good job lobbying. I want to send him to Washington. I've got some cases to plead too.
I bet. But as we said, the field will get the one-to-go signal now. NASCAR has gone over their scoring tapes. They have reconfirmed that everybody's in the correct position. So it'll be Jack Sprague restarting, Bliss in second, Ruttman third, Elliott, Pirelli, Keselowski, Sauter, Crawford, Butch Miller, and Barry Bodine. That's how they're going to reset everybody. Randy Tolsma will restart in 11th. Frank Kimmel is up to 12th. Tony Raines in 13th. Stacy Compton 14th. Ron Hornaday 15th. Kenny Irwin 16th. Harvick will go 17th. Wallace 18th. Chuck Bound 19th. And Lonnie Rush will restart in 20th.
Eli, if there's any question about who's a lap down, all you have to do is look on the restart here. You see him running on the inside there. Those trucks are a lap down.
So about set to go. It'll be green flag as they come by to the stripe. Lap 67 of 175 on the board. Lap 88 is halfway, and that's when they put out the halfway break. Again, these races are run in two segments, as we told you at the very beginning. You see Hornaday, the number 16 truck. He is in 15th position. Waiting for the green, it is in the air, and we are back to work, wrapping up caution number three.
Four wide as they head down towards turn one there. You can see everybody jockeying for position. Whoever that is in the middle, I don't know who it is, but I will know in a second. That's Hornaday, one of the best on restart. Look at him come through there, trying to get back on the tail end of the lead lap. As a matter of fact, he is already.
Right, he has Stacy Compton right there along with him, running in 14th spot, the 86 truck. Hornaday got a great restart.
That's your race leader there, the number two, the silver truck coming down into the straightaway there. You can see him moving to the outside of Mike Wallace as they head down to turn one.
Riding with Hornaday, looking back.
always my favorite way to see the field, just like he is right now. Everybody following him down that back straightaway. One thing about it, on restarts, when you're side by side like this, anything can happen, and usually does.
Working through turn number four, having just wrapped up the third caution flag of the afternoon. Again, the number two truck, who's fifth in line in that pack. He is the race leader. There's Bliss going by. Everybody directly in front of him is on the tail end of the lead lap. 86, now going a lap down. That's Compton.
Stacy Compton, and on the outside, Jack Sprague and also Ruffin moving on the outside there to go by. You can see Sprague really moving in on Bliss as they head down into turn three.
You're riding with Sprague now. He is second in the race, just behind the truck in front of him. But again, those directly ahead are on the tail end of the lead lap.
That was an interesting one. You can see Joe Ruffin stick the nose of his truck right in there, trying to make a pass there on Jack Sprague.
Rutman is in the 80. Compton's doing a great job staying on the tail end of the lead lap.
Well, he's doing what he can, but he's got some mighty fast trucks there. You can see right now that Bliss has kind of turned it up a little bit. He looks in the mirror. He looks at that green truck just behind him, Jack Sprague. He does not want to play with him all day.
Tony Raines is that yellow number 19, the Pennzoil colors being bypassed. And is it going to split them?
Oh, I'm telling you, right through the middle. You can see Bliss just wet to the outside there. Stacy Compton on the inside can't do a thing. Those three trucks are really moving there. You see, Rutman taking a little longer to get by Stacy Compton as they come off turn two.
175, 180 miles an hour. Down the back straightaway and into the corner. Riding with Bliss. He's the race leader, that green truck already winning the championship today. If you're just joining us, Jack Sprague, just by starting the event, has clinched the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series title for 1997. So Skinner, Hornaday, and Sprague, the champions over the last 3 years.
I wouldn't be surprised if Dennis Connors didn't do a little work on Sprague's truck during that little pit stop there. You can see he's a little bit quicker just before they had the caution. The two trucks of Mike Bliss was much quicker. Right now, it looks like Craig can close ground on him when he gets ready to.
Trouble in the corner. Lonnie Rush spins the 97. Also going around, that's Wayne Anderson.
Whoa. Little contact there. It looked like Randy Tolsma got into him just a little bit.
And through the grass go others. Ron Barfield. Barry Bodine has been collected in that as well. A lot of damage on his truck. Chuck Bown was involved, but there is Lonnie Rush Jr., the Ohio native, was the first to start going around there in the corner. He and Wayne Anderson triggering the incident.
Lonnie Rush led the race a little bit last week in Phoenix. I know he's very disappointed. There's Resende finally. You can see the nose on his truck really beat up. The back of the truck also took a lot of damage.
And there was Barry Bodine. Oh, that's a heartbreaker. He was in the top 10, goes behind the wall after getting caught up in the accident.
You can see oil all over the side of the truck. The oil cooler itself is on the left front corner of that truck, and you can see the impact there was right on that corner. It broke the cooler, and it just spilled oil all over the side of the truck.
There's Bob Keselowski. Well, you can see from this angle already that the right front of that Dodge truck is bowed up.
I'd say about half of that truck's missing right now because you can see the right front tire's gone. Right front fender's totally gone, all but just the very top part of the hood.
And there's Lonnie Rush. Let's take a look at what happened again. All of this up there in turn number four, happening at lap number 75. Oh, he got, well, they,
well
one of the
Anderson
two got
made
together.
Contact
yeah.
there, and everybody behind him is just, that's just a, you can see, that's like a wreck on the freeway. Everybody's trying to get by, but there was a lot of damage even past where we're at.
Now, Rich Bickle's truck, look at this. What do you do when you're in a situation? Just point her straight and pray like the Dickens?
Well, you try to go the high side of the racetrack because it is self-cleaning. Let's ride with Keselowski and see what he could see coming off the corner. You can see the trouble up in front. Smoke's everywhere. He's trying to decide where to go right now. He chooses to go low, gets in the backside there of
one thing he couldn't do though was just whoa up in time. And the caution is on the speedway. Let's go to pit road.
Guys, I'm sure I'm glad to see this young man get out of the truck. A terrific impact there, Barry. Tough luck. You had a great run going. What happened?
That restart, you know, we running real good. Got by the lap cars and started catching the lead lap cars. And I don't know what happened, you know, how the crash happened. But by the time Spotter realized it, by the time I realized it, you know, the truck just wouldn't stop. And everybody else stopped. So I ended up hitting the guy in front of me. And tough luck. It was running real good. Had Rhino Linings for a sponsor for this race. And, you know, I got to thank Jim Matei and John Porter for giving me the opportunity to drive the truck. Had a good day going, but bad luck.
Well, you'll have plenty of other good days. The guy, he's just like a veteran. He does it, says all the right things. Here's Bill Stevens.
And nobody's more disappointed than this man, Uncle Brett Bodine. You were standing right here. You saw it right in front of you, and all the color drained out of your face.
Yeah, it was a tough break. Barry's doing such a good job, and, you know, just feel bad for him. He's really got a lot of talent, and these guys are going to see a lot more of him, that's for sure.
You've had this happen to you a few times. What would be the advice you'd give him?
Well, you know, he ran a great race, and he was really taking care of his truck, and, you know, the pit stop, the way the thing shook out there was some green flag stop. Got him towards the back of the line, and that's what happens. The lap truck's got the racing. You know, that's racing. That's what it's all about. He's been in this sport his whole life. He knows what it's all about.
Yeah, tough break for one of this sport's greatest families.
Bob Keselowski and his brother Ron as crew chief going to work on the right front of the Mopar Dodge. Here again is what happened, and you see Rush, that light blue truck, already sideways with Anderson.
They made contact just before this. You can see Anderson in the 97 there, spinning around, barely missing Jay Sauter on the inside. You can see behind them, everybody's driving through the smoke, can't see.
Now watch Barfield going to the grass. He's that green and yellow truck. And now let's listen in as Bob Keselowski rides us through. Rich Bickle also will ride us through the problems.
Sometimes you get lucky. I finally got to see who the red and white truck was that Keselowski got into. That was Doug George.
Indeed, Doug George celebrated a birthday on Wednesday and is awaiting the birth of a child. We're live in Las Vegas with Mike Bliss, the leader.
Today's automobiles are the most complex ever made.
That's why drivers turn to professional automotive technicians
for reliable repairs
and to maintain the safety of their vehicles
for themselves and for their families. For dependable, top-quality parts, pros across the country
turn to Carquest Auto Parts.
To be the best, you've got to use the best.
That's why we depend on over 3,000 Carquest stores coast to coast.
It's got to be Carquest.
Carquest, best for the pros, best for you.
Outperforms Mobile One. New Mobile One 0W30. Superior protection when you start your car.
If you've recently been inducted into baseball's Hall of Fame, you'll love the Econo Lodge Senior Room. There's brighter lighting, so you can show off your Hall of Fame ring. Bigger numbers on the phone. I am in the Hall of Fame. I am in the Hall of Fame. I am in the Hall of Fame. And free in-room coffee. Tastes like it was brewed specially for people in the Hall of Fame.
You can save 30% on a senior room. Call 1-800-55-ECONO.
Tell them Tommy sent you. Oh, tell them I'm in the Hall of Fame.
Oh.
Budweiser. Always brew refresh.
Happy Thanksgiving, everybody. Dig it.
CBS Sports coverage of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series is sponsored by the 3,400 Carquest auto parts stores across North America. You'll find it at Carquest. Mobile One, 100% synthetic motor oil. Nothing outperforms Mobile One. And by Brewery Fresh Budweiser, the king of beers.
We are live with you at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway, working caution for the fourth time this afternoon. The season finale for the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series here in 1997. We saw the 97 truck involved in that spin before as we ride with Rich Bickle around the speedway. And although this may not be a vintage day for Wayne Anderson, Buddy Baker, he was part of the news that was made here this weekend. He's going to replace Kenny Irwin for the Liberty Racing team next year.
Couldn't have picked a better guy. Wayne Anderson from the All-Pro Series, I tell you, he's just he's an all-around driver. He's thrilled to death, and it's bad to see him get into a tangle like that, but you know what? It'll make him a better driver next year.
There is Anderson. Comes from a great racing family, and he will be, as Buddy says, a huge talent to be reckoned with in the future. Track cleanup is continuing after Rush and Anderson and Resendiz and Bodine and Chuck Bown and all spun off the corner. Meanwhile, Bob Keselowski's bunch been working hard on that truck. Let's get an update.
Yeah, Ron Keselowski is the crew chief. He's talking right now to Bob in the truck. This looks like a mini intensive care unit. As soon as we can get Ron. Ron, what's the plan? I know the truck got hurt pretty good.
We're going to go up in a hauler. We're going to cut the side off the truck up in a hole and put it on at the half.
That's the deal. Some cosmetic changes for that truck, but it took a pretty good lick. Let's go to Glenn.
Well, guys, we've moved down into Jack's brakes piece. We've been hearing a little bit of a problem, a little discussion. This is his crew chief, Dennis Conner. And Dennis, what's wrong? Is there a right front shock problem?
It's not really any problem with the shock. It's just the way the chassis is working with the new body rules. The shock that's on there is not valved just exactly right. We're going to put one at the half time that we tested with out here. He's a little loose going in and a little too tight coming off. Hopefully it'll fix both those problems.
Well, they hope that they've got something for Mike List in the second half of this race, guys.
Jack Sprague, who finished second in points to Ron Hornaday last year, winning the championship here in 1997. There he is as he ride with the Quaker State team through the corner here at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. This has been a popular racetrack in its infancy still. Whether it's been NASCAR or open wheel racing that's been here, the drivers just like the wide racetracks. Of course, I know that was something that you liked too, Buddy, but you thrived, of course, and earned your Hall of Fame credentials on these big racetracks.
Well, I tell you what, you can see that the action's nonstop here and three wide down in the corners. What a great place, and it proves that you don't have to run 200 miles an hour to have a great show.
Working caution, fourth time today. The first was for Brian Cunningham, the second for Brian Reffner. Ron Barfield ran out of fuel at lap 61, brought out the third caution, and now the multi-truck incident that wraps up this caution period here at lap number 80. Eight laps shy of halfway, green is in the air.
There trying to get back in the lead lap as he goes down into turn one. The inside groove there, all these trucks are a lap down that are on the inside part of the racetrack as they come off. You can see Stacy does not have quite enough to keep the lead trucks back there.
Leader number two, Bliss.
Fighting back pretty well there. You see Stacy Compton on the inside in the 86 truck as they go down toward turn one. Stacy fighting very hard. He knows in just a few laps the caution will come out for halfway. If he could just stay in front of the lead truck, he would make up that lap.
You've got Rutman in the 80, right behind him the 6 of Corelli, the 94 of Bill Elliott, and how about the 14 for Rick Crawford, a super run for the man who is second in Rookie of the Year points.
It's a miracle that he's even here. His truck on the way to Phoenix a couple of weeks ago, run off the road, tore the truck, his primary truck up, also his tow truck, And this is a backup truck that they're running, and ran very well last week in Phoenix, and you can see he's up front again this week.
Kind of tore up their crew chief, Roland Walonica. Also, he suffered some cracked ribs and a concussion. Roland's a good guy. Hard worker, been around from when he used to drive in NASCAR Winston Cup racing.
I said, I bet you almost had a heart attack. He said, no, I was sleeping just like the driver.
That's typical Roland Walonica for you. Mike Bliss is the race leader. Sprague is second. Joe Ruttman running in third. There you see the spread. They have put Stacy Compton again a lap down. Former late model stock driver from the Virginia area. Did a great job to try and hang with the leaders. Couldn't quite outpower them. Now we're within four laps of halfway. At the halfway point, they pay the bonus for leading the event at halfway, and then one lap later, they put out the caution for that halfway five-minute break.
Eli, look at Rick Corelli in third there. Seems to be able to run a very low line. You can see him moving in. He's really doing a great job.
And we're riding with Rich Bickle back in 17th position now. You saw a quick look at Tony Raines in his rearview mirror. Now you see it from up high. The 19 truck, Raines, right in behind Rich Bickle. You've got Chuck Bown in the 99 Exide truck just ahead, working his way back towards the front again. These are one lap down trucks. Only the top 15 remain on the lead lap.
That's Lance Norrick there in the 90 truck. You can see as they come off the corner there, everybody's trying to find a way by. Lance Nort washes out just a little bit.
The Chevy moving to the inside of the Dodge. And as you ride with Bickle, he'll move past. That wasn't for position. Norrick was running in 23rd on yet another lap, but nevertheless, Bickle made the move. Here's the look back up front. Things are getting a little bit closer now.
We've been told that halfway will be lap 89. We were told that by NASCAR. Look at Sprague making a move on Bliss, going down to turn one.
This is for the lead at lap 88. Again, there are bonus monies on the line if you lead at halfway.
Rick Corelli's in a great spot. He'll get draft off both trucks as they go down the back straightaway, side by side as they go down into turn three.
Riding with Sprague into turn three. Tell you, Bliss has some power to keep it revved up to the outside, and you saw Sprague's truck wiggle. He loses the spot. Corelli grabs second. Ruttman grabs third. Sprague may well get in line in fourth, ahead of Elliott fifth.
Don't count out Joe Ruttman in the safety truck there. He's moved right up on the back bumper there. As he and Corelli come off the back straightaway, looks to me like Corelli has something for him.
Crossed flags are out. We are halfway through the event. The caution will fly the next time by, and now caution is coming out for Doug George's truck. Doug George, who erupts in a plume of smoke as he passes start finish. There you see the problems on Doug George's truck, and the leaders come to the stripe halfway here in Las Vegas. Mike Bliss is the race leader. So Bliss takes him to the stripe at lap number 89. Caution for the fifth time. Halfway home in the season finale. Number 75. Everybody's on the pit lane for the halftime break. Glenn Jarrett's there also with Mike Bliss.
And I'm going to intrude in on the conversation with Crew Chief Barry Dodson and Mike Bliss. Thanks, there, Barry. They've already changed the rubber on the thing, and Mike, pretty awesome looking truck. I don't know what you could do to it to make it better.
Well, we're just a little bit on the tight side. I think we're going to do just a slight tire change, you know, adjustment with pressures or something like that. But, you know, at the end there, we just, ran out of tires. And when you put full fuel in with wore-out tires, she's a little loose. And we're good, though. I'm happy with the ASC Ford and, Robert Yates Power Plant's pulling hard.
We'll let these guys finish work, and here's Bill Stevens.
I am with the pole sitter and the series champion, Jack Sprague. Jack, it looked like a truck got a little loose toward the end there.
Well, it's been a little loose going in all day and a little tight in the middle and off, but they're working on this Quaker State Chevrolet. I believe we got something for them.
You dodged some bullets out there a little while ago. Looks like the truck is pretty unscathed right now.
Well, it's not so bad. It's just a fast racetrack, and everybody's doing what they can to try to win this thing.
He's calm and he's cool. We're waiting for the second half. Let's go back to Glenn.
Thanks,
Bill, and right now is the only time all day that I have seen Bill Elliott be patient at all. Man, you look like a rocket ship out there coming through the field.
Well, his old truck runs awful well, but, you know, it's just so much different than what we normally do, and it seems to work pretty well. I don't know if I got anything for a couple of those guys, but it's a pretty doggone good truck.
I know that had to be fun when you're passing all those guys. That's got to be a lot of fun, Bill.
Well, it is, but still, you know, you have to have a lot of patience, too, to work those guys because you don't race with them every week. You don't know what they're going to do.
Thanks for taking time. Best of luck in the second half. Here's Bill.
And I'm with Joe Rutman. Joe, pretty good run. You're in third place. You got to be happy.
Well, third is better than where we started, but we're still going to have to work on her a little bit. The guys, there's two or three guys is definitely better than we are, and it was that that mate truck was coming on us too, you know, so I don't know what he's got for us, but we're still not quite there. We're going to make some little changes, and hopefully we can fit her a little closer. We're just not turning good enough in the middle, and we just not, if anyone knows how to fix that, call us real quick, and we'll
we'll put the number up on the screen. Back to Glenn.
Well, thanks, Bill, and I'll move down now with Rick Corelli. Another great first half for the High Plains Drifter, and you got to feel good about the way this truck's running.
Well, I tell you what, the Remax Chevrolet is running great. I'm out there having a great time. Today's my birthday. Want to say hi to everybody, and, you know, hopefully we started this winter heat years ago, and maybe we can run up front. But the truck's good, a little tight. Long runs were a little tight, but maybe we got something for them. If this set of tires is good, we'll race the wheels off at the second half.
Well, they're making a few adjustments on the truck. I think Corelli could well be a factor for that win, Eli.
Wouldn't surprise me as well as he was working his way through race traffic. Plenty of time yet for Rick Corelli, a 43-year-old here today. You're not going to find better views anywhere than those that surround the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. And Mike Liss likes the view. He's forming up after the halftime break. We get set to go back racing here in just a short while with Mike Liss, the number two truck, continuing to show the way. There you see, bit by bit, the teams buttoning up the hoods on those trucks. Ron Hornaday beginning to pull away. He's now in seventh position. Wednesday, Hornaday and some other of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series drivers were at the University Medical Center instead of the Las Vegas casinos. Hornaday and Randy Tolsma and Mike Wallace warmed up with the nurses before visiting the children in the pediatric center. The kids received autographs and modeled trucks from the drivers, and most importantly, everybody picked up a lot of smiles.
Hope you're feeling better.
NASCAR's done something great with us, with the TV and stuff. And a lot of kids have seen your face on TV, so to come out here and do that, and they think they see a star, and hopefully you feel like a star to them or a hero, and you come out and give them an autograph and make them smile, that just makes you feel that much better.
That is something very, very special that the drivers have done, not just here in Vegas a few weeks ago. Randy Tolsma led a contingent to the UCLA Medical Center when the series is running in Bakersfield, California. Just a little something that they give back to the community. And while we're talking of medical doings and maybe medical miracles, buddy, how about the great news that Chris Trickle, you remember he was shot back in February? He came out of a coma after 9 or 10 months the other day.
10 months he was in a coma, and his first words were to his girlfriend. He said, "I love you." That's pretty special.
He was fourth last year. It is very special. In the NASCAR Featherlight Southwest Tour standings, underwent a number of surgeries after what was an apparent drive-by shooting. But great, great news for the entire Trickle family as Chris Trickle emerged from a coma just last week to the smiles and the tears of joy from everybody. A great, great story. Field now forming up. We get set to go back to green to begin the second half of the season finale, the Carquest Auto Parts 420K, live here at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Second half of the NASCAR doubleheader here on CBS Sports today. Joe Nemechek earlier winning the season finale for the NASCAR Busch Series down in Homestead. You saw the lights just came back on atop the safety truck, so we are not going green this time. And that's a good break for Bob Keselowski. Don't know if they really hung a whole new side on that truck like Ron was talking. Looked like they had about a side of duct tape.
They cut it off. They did a bad job.
Well, there is a piece there. It is a full fender piece. I guess it's going to try and button it up as best as they can. Glenn, I'll tell you something. It was nice to see old Bill Elliott all smiles down there, and he's right, restarting in fifth.
he's got a shot to take this deal today.
Oh, he does, Eli, but I tell you, they narrowly averted disaster down here. First thing happened was on the racetrack, the oil pump came off of Brian Refner's truck, hit the cowl piece and knocked the cowl flap off. They replaced that. While they were under the engine, Bill was telling them, hey, guys, there's something's wrong with the throttle return springs. They looked under the engine. The bolt had backed out that the spring was attached to. In other words, when he let off the accelerator, it didn't slow down. The throttle could have hung wide open. They think they got everything fixed now. We hope so. Here's Bill.
Well, here's something everybody should have in their toolbox. Look at that Jumbotron. That's what they use to adjust the track bar in one of the trucks. That's how they adjust the suspension. Joe Ruttman mentioned during halftime that that truck wasn't handling well. They couldn't get the end of that wrench into the adjustment on the track bar to do anything, so they're not expecting a whole lot of improvement, buddy. Maybe even elucidate on what that's going to mean to them.
Oh, we'll have to find out, buddy. When you talk about not being able to make the adjustments that you want, unless the track does come to them in the second half of the race, you never know.
Well, you have to look around. That's the one way you do. You have to look for grooves that your truck will work on. If you can't adjust it, of course, you have to change your line around the racetrack. I was talking just a second ago about the piece coming off. Where that's at is right against the windshield. We get a front view of this truck. I'll show you exactly where it's at. I'll draw it for you. It's right in that area right there. And it was a vital piece there because you don't want the air to get under there and mess up the flow of air under the hood. And it also, without that cowl flap, you get around backwards. You don't have the ability to take the pressure out from under the hood and the truck will fly off the ground.
Well, let's see what happens. Second half of the race about set to go. Green is in the air. We are back to work. Lap number 90. 85 laps to settle it. Mike Bliss the leader. Corelli is second. Ruttman third. Sprague is fourth. Bill Elliott restarts fifth. Nick Crawford is sixth. Hornaday seventh. Jay Sauter is eighth. Butch Miller ninth. Kevin Harvick restarts in tenth. Not taking long for Bliss to pull away by about five truck lengths, maybe more.
Well, Rick Corelli's truck looks to be real fast after it gets really on used tires and uses a lot of fuel out. Right now he's able to hang on, though. You see him moving back in on Bliss, but I think his truck is going to be better on long runs.
He gave you the top 10 moments ago. Frank Kimmel restarts in 11th, Kenny Irwin 12th, Mike Wallace 13th, Randy Tolsma 14th, and Bob Keselowski restarting in 15th. And there you have the 15 trucks on the lead lap. Mike Bliss showing the way. And there's the spread now, just a couple of truck lengths.
Well, it'll close up in a hurry. You see Jack Sprague got by Ruttman now, and he'll pull his group right along. The draft here is like any major speedway. They're running well over 170 miles an hour. And with these trucks as fast as they are, Jack Sprague will move right in on the leaders in a hurry.
There's the lap truck of Stacy Compton. He's in 16th now as we continue to drop back and show you where your favorites are running. There's Bill Elliott in 6th. You got a quick look at Hornaday seconds ago. There's Chuck Baum. He's a lap down in 17th. And a good scramble for Crawford and Bickle. Crawford is on the lead lap in 7th. Bickle is a lap down in 18th, but nevertheless, a good side-by-side scramble. Then you've got the 3 truck, Jay Sauter. He's next in line, running 8th. There's Jay. 21. Different look for Butch Miller's truck, but that is he in the number 21. He's running 9th, and there's 10th place, Kevin Harvick. 11th is the 98. Final ride in that machine for Kenny Irwin Jr. The 19, that's 19th place, Tony Raines, a lap down. The 52 is 12th place runner, Mike Wallace. Jimmy Hensley, he's running in 22nd now. The gentleman from Horse Pasture, Virginia. There's Kenny Schrader. He's 25th, driving for A.J. Foyt. Good 3 wide, almost. That time, Norick backed out, but the 61 is Tolsma. The 97 is Anderson, who was involved in the caution back at lap number 75. And then we take it back up front to our leader, Mike Bliss.
Eli, you can see right there, Bliss has a pretty good run there going, but Corelli right now is being overhauled by Jack Sprague as they head down the back straightaway. Sprague gets a great run down through there, Now, they'll break even just about here. You'll see Corelli kind of pull back just a little bit going in the corner, but Sprague really has that truck dialed in.
Don't count anybody out yet because Bliss, Corelli, Sprague, Ruttman, even Hornaday. Unscheduled stop now for Frank Kimmel, the ARCA standout who had started 40th and got as high up as 11th, Glenn, an unscheduled stop.
And it's going to be the last stop, too. Frank is unbuckling himself right now. And, Frank, what a tremendous first half you had. What happened to the truck?
I tell you what, this Chevy truck is really running good. Best truck I've ever driven as far as speed. And it looks like we broke a camshaft. We broke one. Bobby broke one in practice, and I think we broke another one, but it's a real shame.
It certainly is. The Bobby he's talking about is Bobby Dotter, who owns this truck. Frank is a veteran ARCA campaigner, finished second in the ARCA standings this year.
Tough break for Frank Kimmel because he was doing a super job here today. There again, Butch Miller in the 21 and Mike Wallace in the 52. That's 11th and 12th on your screen. Heading to turn three, and just in front of those two is the Irwin-Sauter battle. This is for 8th and 9th. Harvick right there, the 75 truck in 10th.
You see Butch Miller in the 21 truck, the green one there, he's moving in to make it a four-truck battle as they head down into one.
Butch Miller driving with a heavy heart. His mom passed away on Wednesday of this week. Jeannie. Certainly, that as well, you can imagine, praying very hard on Butch Miller's mind. Three wide for the spot. That's for eight. Harvick with a gutsy move in the 75.
He just went down on the bottom part of the racetrack. You can see Kenny Irwin Jr. lead change here.
Here goes Sprague. All it took was Bliss to go a little wide, but now let's see if he can power right back.
Well, right now, what happens, Bliss coming off on the outside there, they'll probably run side by side down into turn three. You see who's benefiting right now. Here comes Corelli on the inside.
They're going to swap it around, lap number 98. Jack Sprague grabs the top spot at lap 98. Bliss now second, Corelli is third.
Here comes Corelli on the inside. It looks like Bliss' truck may have given up a little bit. He's moving back. You see Joe Ruttman in the 80 truck there, moving right back up on Bliss.
Bliss has been dominant, as he was in California when he led 93 of 100 laps there. Good scramble now for fourth. The 16 is Hornaday. The 80 is Ruttman, and Hornaday grabs the spot.
And just back of those guys, Bill Elliott. He's still in this thing.
This is going to be a heck of a finish.
Yeah, it never gets easy. You can see Jack Sprague, though. He went by Bliss, and Bliss is kind of dropping back now. You see Hornaday working him over there. Bliss is in third right now. It looks to me like he's going to lose more position.
100 laps in the book, 75 to put a capper on the season. The championship is settled. Jack Sprague's got it tucked away. Now who's just going to take bragging rights off the Las Vegas Strip when this one is done? CBS Sports coverage of the Carquest Auto Parts 420K will continue after this message and a word from your local station. Back with you in Las Vegas when we signed on the air. We told you that other than Jack Sprague, most every other position in the top 10 or 11 up for grabs today. That's how the numbers stack up right now. And look how tight Bickel and Ruttman continue to be, though the order hasn't changed. And there you see the others and how they are stacking up in the top 10. Mike Bliss, he led so many laps earlier. He is now running in sixth as you watch the battle for the lead. Glenn, what's the deal with Bliss?
Eli, too bad for Mike Bliss and the whole crew that had a great truck. He has an engine problem. They're not sure what it is. They said all the gauges on the truck look good, but the truck is very, very flat. I would suspect some kind of problem in the valve train. Here's Bill Stevens.
I'm with Rick Wren, the crew chief for Rick Corelli. I got one word for you. Yikes!
Yeah, I'll tell you what. That truck's been really good since we unloaded here, and I'll tell you, this is the first time ever on Speedway. Rick said he's been having fun driving a race vehicle.
They qualified 12th. They're second. Watch out.
And that might well have been the first time the word yikes
Watch out his right.
This year.
Watch out his right. The six truck of Corelli's able to keep a lower line off the corner. He's moved right on the tailgate of Craig. As they go through the corner, you can see a lower line right there. That means the truck is sticking very well. Watch him off the corner here. He closed right in on him as they head down the back straightaway.
And folks, he's not done this year. Corelli hasn't led a single lap on a super speedway all season. As a matter of fact, he's only led 10 laps all year, and they were all on the short track in Portland, Oregon, mid-season. Rick Corelli trying to grab the lead away from Jack Sprague. These two trucks have better than 2.5 seconds now on the guys you see in the distance behind them. Hornaday, Ruttman, and Elliott are now 2.5 seconds back of this battle for the lead.
You can see the high plane drifter there. He was giving Jack Sprague a look over there as they started through the corner. You can see him take that lower line. He'll gain about a truck length right there. And out of the corner, he almost pulled even as they start off for the straightaway.
This for the top spot. Ahead of Hornaday, Ruttman, Elliott, Bliss, who's now sixth, Kenny Irwin, seventh, Harvick, Crawford, and Butch Miller, your top 10. Jack Sprague, of course, a many-time winner. Corelli's lone win on the series back in June of 96 at the Bristol Motor Speedway in Tennessee.
That truck is really working well. You can see them as they go down the straightaways. They're about even. They go in the corner. I think right now Corelli's very happy driving along there in the draft. You see him take a lower line right there. He'll get right behind him down the straightaway. And they're breaking away from third, fourth, and fifth trucks. So he's real happy just getting a toe right along here.
It was 2.5 seconds before Glenn. Now it's almost 3 seconds for these guys on third place Hornaday.
The rest of the field, guys, but you know, I'm watching Corelli. He can get close, but he can't seem to get by. And in talking to a lot of the drivers this morning, I found out that when a truck pulls up like Corelli is on Sprague right there, just about that distance, that the second truck picks up a tremendous push off the air off the truck in front of him, and he can't seem to get any closer unless he's a whole lot faster. Right now, those trucks look to be pretty equal. Corelli's going to have his hands full getting by Jack Sprague.
This is the last chance he has to try and duplicate a win from a year ago. As a matter of fact, the three winners of last year who haven't won this year are Skinner, who of course has gone Winston Cup racing and is already behind the wall today. Dave Resendiz, who won last year, has been close this year, but is 15 laps down today. And then the last guy is Corelli.
This is a great shot. This gives you an idea how much air is actually going down the bed of this truck there. You can see the metal flapping there. That means there's a tremendous amount of air going to that rear spoiler. These trucks drive well. Everybody thinks they would be loose because of the tailgate and all, but really and truly they get a tremendous amount of downforce on the rear tires with this huge bed that they have on the back of the truck.
Look at that blade, though, that sticks up in the air, buddy, that rear spoiler. I mean, that's huge.
Oh, it's huge, and you can see it's really getting a lot of air to it, where a lot of race vehicles do not get a lot of air on the spoiler itself. These trucks get as much as you can get it back there.
Only 14 trucks on the lead lap. This race going by in a hurry. Lap 113 of 175.
My, here's Bill Elliott slowing down the back straightaway.
Problems for Bill Elliott. You hate to see that, as well as they were running in fifth spot. And Bill Elliott now will be heading towards the pit area. So here's how it stacks up now. You've got Sprague, the leader, the 24. Corelli, the 6, is running in second. What's the deal, Glenn? What are you hearing from Mike Beam?
Well, Eli, lots of trouble down in the pits here. Of course, he's a teammate to Mike Bliss. Bill Elliott just called in, said the motor went out on his truck. Engine trouble also for Bill Elliott. Wow, it hit them both within about a 15-lap period. Terrible, terrible break for two really fast trucks.
Glenn, we have a lead change. You can see Rick Corelli has gone by the 24 truck and put about a 5-truck left lead over him.
And that's all it took. The opening was there. Corelli blew right by. First laps, he is leading on a super speedway this year. Watch it again, folks, and see how it happened for Corelli to take the lead from Jack Sprague at lap 115.
Okay, you see Rick Corelli on the outside there. Looks to me like Jack Sprague fell off the pace quite a bit going down into turn three. The six truck just went right on by. That looked like ignition trouble or something just for a second.
So riding along with Jack Sprague for the first time in a while, he is looking forward to the race leader. We're live at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. The lap's winding towards a conclusion, as is the season. Corelli looking for his first win of the year. Way, the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, Rick Corelli at lap 115 taking the lead from the truck that had been dominant today, Jack Sprague. Just joining us, we've had five caution flags, but none here in the second half of the race. All five cautions coming in the first 89 laps of the day. In the garage, Troy Beebe, Brian Reffner, Barry Bodine, and Mike Skinner, Boris Said, Lonnie Rush, Frank Kimmel, and most recently, Bill Elliott. But the big story in the last few moments, the fact that Rick Corelli, the number six Remax truck, has taken the lead for the first time on a big super speedway in 97. He's done no better than third on the big tracks all year, and that was in Loudoun, New Hampshire. So Bill Stevens, they've got to be tickled on the pit lane.
Lots of smiles down here, Eli, and Rick Wren, the crew chief. You can pretty much give us some insight on that pass we just saw.
Yeah, you know, Rick didn't have a lot of real speedway experience, so I told him if he could stay right with Jack, if he could maybe sneak up on his back bumper, maybe he could loosen him up enough, maybe we could get around. We've had a real good truck, and right now we got around Jack, we pulled away a little bit, so that kind of hurting our fuel mileage, but everybody's got to stop one more time, so as long as we have a good pit stop, we don't have the altercations, maybe it'll be a good day.
It will be a good day. It's his 43rd birthday for Corelli today. Let's go to Glenn with Jack Sprague's crew.
Well, Bill, while you guys are smiling down there, I'm up in Jack Sprague's pits, and they are frowning here. Sprague reports that they have a very ill-handling truck. It's very, very loose. He does not like the way it feels. He's just had to back off. They're hoping for a caution so they can come in, get some fuel, and make an adjustment.
So there are the updates from the pit lane here at lap 123. The lead is 2.25 seconds. Now you look back to third, fourth, and then the lap truck of Chuck Bown in the 99. But Hornaday in the Napa number 16, the 80 of Ruttman, and here comes Bown, who, remember, earlier in the day was running in the top five, then went back, then got involved in an accident that sent him again to the rear of the field. One more time, he's climbing towards the front. He's only a lap down in 14. Tony Roper in the 31, having been lapped many times, 25 laps down today. Here on the lead lap, the 99 Chuck Bown is not. Look at the hood just flapping on Keselowski's truck behind after all the damage that that Dodge has undergone today.
Well,
we're riding with it right now.
He does not have a right front fender in the air. It's just up under the hood there. Hopefully it'll stay on until the end of the race. You can see the hood pins on the front up there sticking up. They're holding it in place, and the back hinges there seem to be in good place. But let me tell you, that's a lot of air going under the front of that truck.
Miller has just called it a day. He's taken his truck to the garage area. There's a good scramble from 8th, 9th, and 10th. Rick Crawford, Mike Wallace, Jay Sauter, and add that yellow truck, Randy Tolsma, former USAC standout, the 61, the winner at Bakersfield, California. Tony Reeves also in the picture in the 14th position, the Pennzoil truck. Reigns not being shown on the lead lap again at this moment.
Close in about four truck lengths getting into the corner on the three trucks that he's trying to run down there. Going in the corner, well, but down the straightaway, it seems the Ford and Chevrolet just a little quicker.
Reigns was involved in that spin back on lap number two. He and Brian Cunningham went around around together. This is for position now. Eighth spot up for grabs, the 52 of Mike Wallace inside of Rick Crawford.
You can see Jay Sauter kind of drop back there when they went too wide into the corner there. Now he makes a move on the outside of Wallace as they go down into turn three.
That was impressive when Crawford just punched it there and pulled away. Left Wallace in his wake.
Jay Sauter's got a very good truck. You see him making it three wide there in the black truck going down into turn one.
That was
right
Kenny,
now.
Kenny Bouchard kind of got caught up in that mix there, that red number 77 you saw.
You see Mike Wallace fighting back very hard in the 52 there. He and Sauter are going at it down the back straightaway. Same Sauter's very good down the straightaway.
Problems as he took the truck behind the wall. What'd you find out, Bill?
Big problems, Eli. They blew the motor. Just flat simple. The rods popped out of that block. They are done for the day, and that's a disappointment. There's a truck that had everybody muttering during qualifying. They came in number seven, but the day is done for Butch Miller and the guys.
So the attritionless bros, and look at that. Hornaday giving a little shot to the caboose there on Chuck Bown. Remember, Hornaday is running third. Bown is a lap down in 12th.
And teammate Joe Ruffin is just behind there, so this is not helping matters at all. This teammate right now, Hornaday giving him a little chrome horn there down the back straightaway.
And again, he'll push him aside. Remember, we talked teammates here. Bound in the 99, Ruttman in the 80, both driving for Jack Roush Racing.
Well, you can see right now, Ruttman has the outside line as he pulls even with the Hornaday truck down the back straightaway, using his teammate to draft right on by.
Rick Corelli continues to lead here in Las Vegas. And CBS Sports coverage of the Carquest Auto Parts 420K will continue after this message and a word from your local station. Well, you gotta love those front hood pins. It's the back that just doesn't quite get the job done. This is Bob Keselowski. Remember we showed you how that hood was flapping earlier? Watch what happened at high speed.
Well, you can see the air getting under the right front corner there. It's already turned loose on the right side. The left side's trying to break loose. Now, how would you like to be running 170 miles an hour? We're on top of the truck with this camera, but guarantee the windshield, he can't see anything.
He quickly goes to the apron of the track, lets everybody go by. Tough, tough break, though, for Keselowski. He's now running back in 20th, and the crew going to the work. And, oh, a tough break, too, for Randy Tolsma. As Keselowski pulls onto the track, Tolsma, running in the top 10, has gone to the garage area. So Tolsma's day done with an apparent engine problem. As all of a sudden, the attrition list continues to grow. And look right there, Corelli, the 6, going around the 15th place, Rich Bickle, putting him a second lap down.
Wow, I'm telling you, Rick Corelli right now, you can see that truck really scoot down the straightaway there. He put Bickle about 4 trucks in the back just on that one straightaway.
The pace we are seeing here as pit stops begin, scheduled for Wayne Anderson. The pace Corelli is setting here, buddy, I wouldn't think he's abusing the tires. I mean, we've not seen that as a problem here in Vegas.
Eli, the only thing he's racing right now is the racetrack. And when you do that, you run your best line around the racetrack. If anything, he's taking it easy on the tires because he's not racing with other people.
Glenn, what about Randy Tolsma? Went to the garage. What are you hearing?
Eli, several laps before that, before he went to the garage, we saw a lot of smoke coming out of the truck. Going into the turns, it got worse, but then it started all the way around the speedway. So I have to agree with you. There's some kind of internal engine problem. Tough luck for Randy, who just picked up his first Truck Series win less than a month ago.
He really did at Bakersfield, California. Meanwhile, the 3 and the 52, Sauter and Wallace, still a dandy battle for 7.
Look at Tony Raines in the 19 there in the corners. This truck is very, very good. You see him put almost as he's starting off, you can see that Wallace fights back on the outside. But he had closed in on these trucks, about 15 truck lengths, and he's really flying in the corner from straight away, nowhere.
We should be within 5 laps of seeing most all of the leaders come in for fuel if the numbers that they used in the first half of the race will carry over. Matter of fact, Kenny Irwin peels off the racetrack here at lap 139 as you watch the ongoing battle. Irwin will make his stop And the fans are getting set for what should be a dandy of a finish here in Las Vegas. Can Rick Corelli get his first big track win? Stick around to find out. The lead is still 5.8 seconds for that truck, Rick Corelli, over second place Joe Ruttman. He is 6.5 seconds up on Jack Sprague, 8.5 on Hornaday, better than 14 seconds ahead of Mike Bliss. There you see the spread. Here's Ruttman right there, your second place truck.
He's just in front of him is his teammate, Chuck Bounce. And Chuck's truck is really, really quick right now. Not able to run the leader down, but he's closing ground on him, and he's taking Ruttman right along with him.
They're moving right on to the front. Again, most everybody's a lap down. The pace the leaders have been setting. Here's Tony Roper in for service. He's in 30th position. Joe Ruttman now makes a stop. These stops, as you see in the left of your screen, lap 145. You see Butch Miller back on the racetrack. He just went by there, the number 21 truck. Everybody coming in for a stop, Glenn.
Yeah, Eli, and Joe Ruttman's coming down ever so slowly. The speed limit during the race is 60 miles an hour, and it seems to be an interminable trip down pit road. Ruttman comes in. They're going to put one can of fuel. They can make it on one can only. No chassis adjustment on the truck. They like the way it's running and driving right now. Joe is trying to get away, and he leaves before they got all the fuel in it. We'll have to check and see if he can indeed make it.
And here comes the leader. As Ruttman leaves, Corelli is on the pit lane. So Rick Corelli gives the lead now to Jack Sprague. Bill Stevens.
Rick Corelli is now in, and Rick Wren, the crew chief, says just fuel. As you can see, they're in. Boy, if the gas station down the street did it like this, wouldn't life be a better place to live? He's out again. Watch that truck.
I have doubts about you there, Mr. Stevens. There's our new leader, Jack Sprague. He will come in now, and that should cycle things back on around again to Corelli, pending the pit stops for Bliss and Crawford. Now, Bliss is right now the race leader, but again, he'll have to stop. Crawford will stop at Hornaday, and that'll cycle things back on around to Corelli. Mike Bliss led most recently through lap 89. Then Sprague, Corelli, and Sprague again. Glenn Jarrett's watching this stop.
And also fuel for Sprague will be one can, and they've made a pretty serious chassis adjustment through the right rear. Crew chief Dennis Connor Jackson wedge, and it was very, very loose. Sprague is down and away. To update you on Ruttman, I watched him weigh the fuel can. He did indeed get the full fuel can in Ruttman's truck. He should be good to go.
Other stops now taking place. But Mike Bliss continues on his way around. Bliss with everybody else having stopped for fuel and tires at the halfway point.
Eli, I see a truck going very, very slow down the back straightaway. It looks to be
Rich Bickle.
Rich Bickle, as you can see there, the 17 truck going very slow down the back straightaway.
So Darrell Waltrip Motorsports driver, Rich Bickle, who, as you see, came in 177 points down to Jack Sprague. And didn't have second place locked in totally. This could be one of the longest laps of the year for him, that's for sure. There's the leader still, Mike Bliss. Glenn, what are you hearing from Bickle's punch?
Well, the main thing I heard, Eli, is Rich told him to get a can of ether ready. He has run it out of fuel. Of course, they use ether to help start the truck once they run it completely out of fuel. So Rich Bickle went one lap too far.
So he is in, and right behind him comes Mike Bliss, the race leader, coming down the pit lane right behind Bickle. There he is, and Bill Stevens is awaiting the stop from the Team ASE entry.
Bliss screams to a stop, just fuel. He'll have to go a long way to make a quicker pit stop than the race leader was before this pit stop, Rick Corelli. A little bit longer, but he's off like a lone ranger.
So that will hand the lead to the number two man and rookie of the year points, Rick Crawford. The number 14 truck will take over the lead, but he too has to make his stop.
Okay.
And here he is now coming in. So all of this cycling around under green flag competition, this will put Corelli back atop the leaderboard after Crawford makes a stop. And Corelli indeed is the race leader. You just saw Jimmy Hensley on the pit lane as Crawford went by him. Roland Walonica and the crew will take care of Crawford. But the RE/MAX team is again showing the way here in Las Vegas. Lap 151, Corelli back atop the leaderboard. Bill Stevens is watching Rick Crawford stop.
Yeah, and he just got fuel, a wipe of the windshield in the front of the truck, and he was away as well. So if you're scoring these pit stops, nobody got an advantage. They were all very quick.
You see Ron Esau in the nine. That's Wilbur Bunce's truck. Making a stop right there. So everybody will clearly be able to go the distance. We're at 152 going to 175.
Eli, I'm watching Rick Corelli out there. He looks to have everything pretty well in hand. I tell you, Joe Rutland's closing in ever so slowly on him. I noticed just a second ago he's moving closer and closer every lap.
He's still 4.3 seconds back. So that's still a goodly distance. Corelli, who finished 8th in Homestead, 22nd in Texas, 15th in California, trying for a big track win here today. It is 4 6/10 of a second, the lead that fat truck Rick Corelli enjoys over Joe Rutman, who's running second. 8.5 seconds back is Jack Sprague. There is second place Rutman. So really the lead right now staying pretty standard, pretty set for Corelli, not losing, nor is he gaining on Joe Rutman. And you know, Glenn Jarrett, to think about it, a week ago, a fifth place run at Phoenix. They've had some good top five and top 10 runs here lately. This team's going to be tough come next year.
Well, I think so, Eli, and that's exactly what they're looking forward to. They all told me this morning they wanted to do well today. They thought they might have a truck capable of winning the race, and they want to end the season on a great note. Right now, Rick Wynn and the rest of the crew are telling Rick to just take it easy, just coast around when you can. You've got a half a straightaway lead. Don't push the truck. Meanwhile, Rutman's guys are running in second. They're telling him to maintain his pace. They don't think Corelli's tires can last. We're going to find out soon enough.
We will find out. We're at lap 158 of 175. Rick Corelli, one of only five drivers who has competed in all 70 NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series races. There you see the interval. Feedback to Joe Rutman. Yep, Butch Miller, Hornaday, Rutman, Sprague, and Corelli. The five drivers to compete in every single race in series history.
Well, he's run all over the world, really. They call him the High Plains Drifter for one reason. He used to go anywhere and win. He's been on the East Coast, he's been in the Midwest, and also won a ton of races on the West Coast.
Here's fifth, sixth, and seventh right here on your screen. The battle for sixth as Sauter in the three, moving inside of Kenny Irwin Jr. in the 98.
See the three truck there of Jay Sauter get way sideways, getting down in the corner there. He just about lost control.
Bliss there in the number two. He's running fifth. He was running fifth. That quickly as both guys, Irwin and Sauter, go by.
Not a good feeling when you're driving your heart out and a guy passes you on the outside in the corner. It kind of takes the wind out of your sails, if you know what I mean. So he's doing his best right now. You can see Jay Sauter in the three truck fight, but Bliss much quicker getting into the corner there. As he picks up the throttle, he should get on by the three truck pretty quick.
Just 14 laps to go. Butch Miller, he had gone to the garage again. He has returned yet again. He's running in 28th spot ahead of the oil mine. Come loose. Always race traffic.
So much for taking it easy. You can see him threading through there. Right now he's into a rhythm. The one thing a driver never wants to do is break that rhythm. Once you get where you're running a good groove around the racetrack, taking it easy sometimes is like playing football half-throttle. You get clipped about the time you break out, and you really need to run that same line, same speed all the time.
Well, the 75 and the 52, Harvick and Mike Wallace, both just went a lap down. Bill Stevens, any concern from Rick Wren that his driver, Corelli, might be using up his tires?
Not only that, but they did not get all of the fuel into the truck on the last stop. They are concerned about the gasoline.
Oh,
I just talked to him. He had his computer out. He was writing numbers on the back of his hand. That's the wild card right now.
Boy, that is a wild card.
Yeah, I'm not worried about the tires because right now, Rutman's running as fast as he is. He's just holding his own right now. But the real concern is not getting the fuel into the truck enough to get to the finish line.
And to the garage goes Kenny Irwin Jr. There goes the Ray Bestis truck. Final ride for Kenny for Liberty Racing before Wayne Anderson takes over next year. Of course, Kenny Irwin going NASCAR Winston Cup Racing, replacing Ernie Irvin for Robert Gates' team. The 35 and the 43, Barfield the 35, Hensley the 43, Kenny Schrader in the 50, all many laps down. You know, the pace they're setting today, only six trucks are on the lead lap, and then only four more are only a lap down. Everybody else is at least two or more laps down.
With 10 laps to go, you know Pirelli right now knows the situation. They probably told him that we're a little bit concerned on the fuel. That has to be going through his mind, I'm sure.
Series champion. Watch this interval. 6 seconds from first Corelli. And we'll wait a while for the 80 truck to come by. There he is, Joe Rutman. 6.3 seconds back.
Eli, what happens? A lot of times the flagman works with the lead truck, and when you get back for a second, you're in a lot of traffic. One lap around there tied up in lap traffic can really hurt you.
Is for position 7th and 8th, Mike Wallace, Kevin Harvick. They're each a lap down. Correct myself, each a couple of laps down, but nevertheless battling for position. Wallace with the strength to hold him off. Mike Wallace's truck is owned by Kenny Schrader. Schrader driving today for A.J. Foyt. And he's in 15th, Ken Schrader is. Nothing up front. That's why we're staying with this battle right here. Up front, it's still 6 seconds for Corelli over Rutman.
One thing we will tell you, though, with seven laps to go, it's getting down to crunch time right now. There is some question whether they have enough fuel in the leader right now. Rutman there in the 80 truck, I'm sure that right now he may be 6 seconds back. Let me tell you, it don't take one little bobble, and he'll be right on top of the race leader.
Glenn, what are you hearing about the race leader?
Well, right now, Eli, we're listening to everything that Rick Rinn and Rick Corelli are saying to each other, and the last thing Rick told him was when you come up on another truck, ride behind me for a while, try to draft as much as possible, save fuel. They told him he's got a 6.5 second lead, and he needs to back off considerably and let it get down to about 6 seconds flat. They want Rick to slow down. They're just practically begging him on the radio to slow that truck down.
Putting a lap on the 50 of Ken Schrader. The 71, Butch Gilliland, who won the NASCAR Winston West Series Championship here a night ago. Well, it's staying right at 6 seconds. Like Glenn said, it's 5.997 seconds, the lead that Corelli has on Joe Rutman.
You know, we're talking about a half a gallon or a gallon of fuel. It may be the difference is what they didn't get in the truck. So I'm sure they're right now, everybody in the pit down there has their fingers crossed. You can see Rutman there running along in second. He knows the situation too. I'm sure they scan each other and they know what's going on in each other's pits.
Of course, Rutman won last week. This man right here hasn't won since June of 96. He's hurting for a victory. Four laps to go. 5.4 seconds. Sprague Vegas 7 seconds back. Hornaday 14 seconds back. Sauter and Bliss, the only other trucks on the lead lap there, Sprague. But let's stay right here and wait and see with everybody whether Corelli has enough fuel to go the distance.
Boy, what a camera angle. You could see his hand on the top side of the steering wheel going through the corner there. Looked like it was frozen there. That's how good that truck's handling right now. He's not fighting it at all. Hands very still through the corner. But that's not the concern. I'm sure he's worried. Do we have enough fuel?
When the Craftsman Truck Series...
Oh, he's coming in the pit.
Corelli is having to pit. Corelli has to pit. I dare say the truck started to burp. And there is the new leader, Joe Ruttman. Bill Stevens is standing by alongside a man who must be crestfallen, Rick Rand.
He's not standing. Look at him. He is flying right out to the truck with the starter fluid. The pit crew just threw their hands up and spun around almost like the Rockettes when they saw the truck slow down. The truck is sputtering. It is dying. It ain't getting very far. And I think the hay is in the barn.
How about it? And there is the race leader. He won at Walt Disney World. He won last race at Phoenix. He ran on the road course in Heartland Park, Topeka, Kansas. And he won in Sonoma, California. White flag for Joe Ruttman. Sprague is running second. Joe Ruttman. He's had heartbreak this year, but he is also very much like we saw in Topeka, Kansas, where on the very last lap, Jay Sauter, the race leader, ran out of fuel, giving Ruttman the win. Same scenario here in Las Vegas. One man rolls lucky seven. One man has rolled snake eyes. Joe Ruttman wins the season finale in Las Vegas, and Jack Sprague wins the championship for the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. How about that, Vince?
Eli, we were just talking about it. Tires were not a problem, but the fuel certainly was. What a heartbreaker for Rick Corelli, I'm telling you. I thought he'd miss it.
Fifth win this year for Joe Ruttman of Upland, California, now makes his home in Nashville, Tennessee. And Corelli's crew just cannot believe it, nor can I for that matter. That's amazing. Now, what are we talking about, guesstimate here, buddy, for a lap and a half of fuel? What is that, a splash?
Just a splash. You know, you can sometimes get a little antsy to get out of the pits and maybe go before they finish putting all the fuel in. What a heartbreaker, though. But, you know, congratulations to Joe Ruttman. 2 weeks in a row now, a winner. And the Jack Rouse team has really worked well with him. These guys are winners, so, you know, for one, it's disappointment. For another, a great day.
And though Chevrolet has won the Manufacturers' Championship and Sprague celebrates his victory, that was 8 wins for Ford with Joe Ruttman getting the win here today. So Sprague celebrates his win of a championship, and we'll be talking to him. We'll talk to that man, Joe Ruttman. Lots more coming up from Glitter Gulch. We're live in Las Vegas, and more on CBS Sports right after this.
Sports coverage of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series is sponsored by the 3,400 Carquest Auto Parts stores across North America. You'll find it at Carquest. And by Pennzoil, formulated for today's stop-and-go driving. Stop, go, Pennzoil.
Well, in disbelief for many, Joe Ruttman is in victory lane. He has won 3 of the last 5 races, Glenn, and look at that smile.
Yeah, that is a big smile. And Joe's finally getting out of the truck. It took a little time there to catch his breath.
When you get this old, you know, you don't want to move too fast. You know? I had no idea that, I got to be honest, I didn't know who he was. I'm going, there was that sixth guy. I don't know who that is. And he was like long gone, and I'm going, I don't, and I seen Sprague start to move in on me, and I, you know, truthfully, I didn't realize that we had won. I knew that we had we'd run second, and we were trying to dig for second in the points is what we were going after, and that's really what we were thinking about, you know.
I'm going to pick on you a little bit. Did you not pay attention in the driver's meeting when they told you where Victory Lane was? I've been chasing you up and down pit road for the last 5 minutes.
No, I don't pay any attention. You never count your chickens before they're hatched. And when you get this old, you know, I'm going to get too excited because no telling what might happen. But this is super for the whole Roush crew and myself and the five wins. I'm not sure that I won. I just got to congratulate the guys with the green machine. They were just a little bit too much for us in the championship run. We thought we could have something for them, but they just were more consistent than we were.
Congratulations again, Joe, to you and your entire team. What a fantastic finish to the season, Eli. These guys will be tough in 98.
They will be, winning three of the last five. And for the record, the old guy, as he calls himself, is 13 days past his 53rd birthday. Not that old at all. Let's check out how your favorites came across the line. Joe Ruttman, Sprague, Hornaday, Sauter, Bliss, and old Rick Corelli had to settle for sixth. That's a heartbreaker right there. Mike Wallace, Kevin Harvick. Chuck Bound battled back nicely, buddy. Look, he had a good ninth place finish.
Great run. He was faster than his teammate at portions of the today, but he got a lap down and never could make it up.
There you see where Keselowski finally finished. Rich Bickle in 7th and 16th position. We'll see how that impacts the points shortly. Kenny Schrader in 18th for A.J. Foyt. On down the line, Ron Esau, Bouchard, gone. There's Kenny Irwin in his final race. Randy Tolsman was running well, but had to settle for 30th today. And then those who went out early, Bill Elliott had his problems. And on down to Brian Cunningham, who brought out the first caution flag of the day way back on lap number two. Well, the season is done, but the celebrating isn't for that man or for Jack Sprague. Sprague's the champion. We'll talk about it when we come back.
You know, I can tell just by looking whether a vehicle's been driven hard or not. This guy is one of my regular customers. Scorched brake rotors, beat up oil pan, probably never takes his foot off the gas. And he trusts me to make sure it performs when he needs it most. So there's only one brand of auto parts I trust, Carquest. I mean, you never know. Someday, he might need to give me a ride.
Carquest, the professional choice.
Yeah, so what are we going to do tomorrow?
The new redesigned Ford Ranger. The only compact pickup built Ford tough.
Don't forget, folks, you can get online at cbs.sportsline.com. Get all the information about this race we've just seen and all your favorite NASCAR news. cbs.sportsline.com gives you all the latest information. And remember, coming up tonight on CBS, how did Touched by an Angel get touched by an angel and end up in ratings heaven, where in Hollywood, it's the only heaven that counts. That story and Andy Rooney tonight on 60 Minutes. That's followed by Touched by an Angel and the CBS miniseries, The Third Twin. That's all tonight here on CBS. Bill Stevens, how about a championship celebration?
Oh, you can feel the love down here. Jack Sprague, his Quaker State Hendrick crew is here, and he's about to get the trophy he's waited a long time for from the Vice President of Administration for NASCAR, Dennis Hooth.
Jack, I want to congratulate you from all of us at NASCAR, and especially Bill Frantz, President of NASCAR, for your entire team. Jimmy Johnson, the manager, Dennis Conner, the crew chief, the entire team here, and of course, Rick Hendrick back home. Congratulations, you're going to make a great champion for NASCAR and the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series for 1997.
Yeah. Jack, I know for a fact after last year, it's even more sweet this year to win this championship.
Well, it is. You know, these guys have done a great job, and everybody back at Motorsports has done a great job. You know, this will be good medicine for Rick. And, you know, we ran good today. I think we were a little better at the end. We just didn't have time to catch him, but we were off a little bit up until that last stop. So it was a good day. We finished second. We got the championship. I'm just proud as heck of these guys, Quaker State, all the fans for buying Quaker State oil and letting this be possible for this team. And I just can't say enough for the whole team.
And I know that it feels special because of all the difficulties the boss has had this year.
Well, it does, and you know, these guys, like I said, have worked their guts off for 2 years for me, and they've given me everything they've had, and I've tried to give them everything I've had, and they deserve this championship. I'm happy for them.
Jack Sprague, your 1997 champion. Eli.
All right, thanks a lot, and congratulations down there. Let's check in now with a guy who's got to be pleased in one regard with a good run, but I can't imagine what's going through Rick Corelli's mind, Glenn Jarrett.
No, and you know what, Eli? It's amazing to me. The man has a smile on his face. Rick, what a terrible way to lose a race. You had him covered.
We had him covered, man. The Remax Chevrolet was awesome today. You know, I found something down here. Chevrolet had a test, and I treated 3 and 4 like 3 and 4 in Phoenix, and I run real well in Phoenix. And I got the truck to drive there where I needed to drive, but you know, unfortunately, we were a couple laps short. I was backing off, trying to save some fuel, and I don't know if they didn't get it all the way full, or we got to work on some fuel mileage. But I'll tell you what. I've lost a lot in my life, but this is a tough one to lose. But you know what? Everybody knew we were here. I told them a long time, you get me something to drive, I can drive it. But we had something to drive today, and unfortunately, we came up short.
Well, I guarantee you, this has got to excite you guys. What a great finish to this season, getting you ready for next year. You guys are going to come out loaded for bear.
That's a fact. We're coming out loaded for bear. The only thing is, I want to give myself a birthday present, and I figured that was going to be a good one. But unfortunately, we'll get them next time.
Happy birthday to us. Sorry the thing happened the way it did. Back up top to Eli.
All right, Glenn, thanks a lot. Now, buddy, let's put a capper on what we talked about on the pre-race and take a look at how the points will shake down.
Well, Rich Bickle still in second, you can see. Joe Ruttman third. Mike Bliss ended up fourth. Ron Hornaday was fifth, and Jay Sauter brought it home in sixth.
Only a point there between Bickle and Ruttman, with Bickle finishing 16th and Ruttman winning. And there you see the others, Chuck Bound by 100 over Kenny Irwin to hang on.
You know, the points are real important, but a good call to Mike Bliss. He soldiered along with a cylinder out of that car. Could have been a winner and couldn't make it.
Jack Sprague, quite a season for him. Hope you've enjoyed our coverage today from Las Vegas. For Buddy Baker, Bill Stevens, and Glenn Jarrett, this is Eli Gold saying so long from the Las Vegas Motor Speedway, where Joe Ruttman has won the 1997 Carquest Auto Parts 420K. Don't forget, next Saturday on CBS at 1:30 Eastern, it's live coverage of the Franklin Templeton Shark Shootout from Thousand Oaks, California. That's followed by NASDAQ College Football on CBS as the LSU Tigers host the Notre Dame Fighting Irish. Been a presentation of CBS Sports, home of the Daytona 500. Joe Ruttman has won the Carquest Auto Parts 420K. Hope you've enjoyed our coverage. Jack Sprague wins the championship as we bid you good night from Las Vegas.